This next speaker is a very creative individual, I have to admit. Bill Boswell with Siemens PLM, Senior Director, Partner Strategy, has a very engaging presentation. I hope you enjoy it.
Good morning. When I was here with you last year with the Assistant Secretary of Labor, we talked about a crisis in manufacturing that was being driven by a global aging workforce, increasing product and process complexity, and an education or skills gap. We still face those challenges, but we're seeing signs of a manufacturing renaissance, and STEM education plays a key role in that resurgence. Today, we're going to focus on student innovation. We're going to hear some amazing stories about some amazing people using great technology. And by the end of today's talk, you should be able to answer the question, what has red arms, green wheels, and defies gravity? Now let's get started.
I'm Daniel, nice to meet you. And my arm is really short, and my elbow's right here, and my arm is pretty long, but there's stuff I can't do, and I don't care about it. Like, I can't do the monkey bars, I can't ride a bike very well, and I can't swing a bat very well. My great-great-uncle had the same arm just like me.
How do I describe my brother? He's my brother.
I taught him everything I know.
We live in a small town in Indiana. There's lots of farm.
And a lot of dirt.
Lots of corn, horses.
There's horses, all right.
And of course, my brother.
Why did the dinosaur cross the road?
I just don't get it. I just don't get the whole dinosaur thing.
Daniel's more like my dad.
Not typical at all. You know, Daniel's been always kind of curious. He's always trying to figure things out.
Daniel, you want to help these two students with a project?
So my mom called the school, thinking they might be able to build something for Daniel. And then two engineers showed up.
Hi!
And that's Prince Maxwell, Izzy B. Black.
Can you get the dog, please?
I can do jingle bells.
Okay, so it really wasn't that bad. And to be fair, Daniel really got involved in the design. Into it.
At first they asked me what color I wanted, and I said I want red. The second thing they asked me, what kind of strap do you want? So I chose the strap to strap it around my arm, so you don't need any help. The third thing they asked me, what kind of prosthetic do you want? A claw or something, three-finger thing. I didn't want the hand because I thought it would be too heavy. I didn't want the claw because it looked like scissors. The third thing was the hook that could pinch stuff. And that's what I wanted, period.
When I went to the presentation, I realized that there's a bunch of other students doing the same thing for other people, like my brother. It wasn't just a prosthetic, it meant so much more to Daniel than we can even imagine. And he's always willing to just try something new, and that's what I really like about Daniel. It was very cool just being able to see that side of him. That's pretty cool.
What a powerful story. Daniel and his family are amazing people, and so are those students. You know, this 3D senior design project that Rose Holman Institute of Technology using solid edge and 3D printing changed the lives of everyone that was involved in the project. That included the film crew as well. So the film crew actually lived on campus in the dorms with the students. They stayed with the professors in their homes over break, and they got to know that family firsthand to be able to tell this story right. So I ask you, would you want to hire students with experience like that? I think you would, and I think we need more like them. We need more like them because, according to a World Economic Forum report, the future of global manufacturing is really going to turn into a competition for global resources. According to the report, there are over 10 million unfilled manufacturing jobs in the world today, and those shortages persist despite high unemployment rates in many of the countries that have the biggest shortages. And that shows to show you that it's not a shortage of people, it's a shortage of people with the right skills and the right education. You can see that the biggest gaps are in India and China, but in third place is the US. We have an education gap. So that talent gap is a problem for employers everywhere, and it really is threatening world economic growth. According to another report, again by the World Economic Forum, but this one in conjunction with Boston Consulting Group, many nations are going to face a significant talent shortage within the next decade. So where will you get your next generation of employees? You're going to be not only competing with the company down the street for those individuals, you're going to be competing with companies on the other side of the world. So how does sustainability awareness drive interest in STEM? By 2030, 60% of the world's population will live in urban areas, and 80% of the world's wealth will be concentrated in cities. So that's going to lead to more congestion and more pollution. So this is a problem that students live with every day and that they're interested in solving. Nobody wants to live in a dirty world, and everybody can relate to cars and transportation. So now, let's move into the next section and talk about some great projects that are embracing sustainability as a way to get students interested in STEM education. The first project we'll talk about is a competition called Green Power. So Green Power is dedicated to promoting engineering and technology to students from ages 9 to 25. Now, this competition is based in the UK today, but we have our first teams from the US traveling to compete in the competition this year, and we expect to expand this program to more countries as we move on. So it's a very exciting technology. The program is all around having students build and race electric vehicles. And so we'll talk through some of the neat segments that they have in that project. So this is the Formula Goblin division. So look at this picture, elementary school students, parents, teachers, that are building electric cars from kits, and then they actually get to race them. How much fun would this be? This is be a lot more fun than a video game that a kid's going to be driving. It's like a real-life version of Mario Kart, although hopefully without the bumping into each other. As you move up in the age groups, the designs become more complex, and teamwork becomes more critical. But again, look at the smiling faces on the students involved with this. And the thing that I think is so important is look at the mix of young men and young women. As we all know, we have to get more women interested in engineering as well. When you get up to the college and the university level, the designs become even more impressive and the competition becomes even more intense. And look at this picture. I just love it. It just looks fast, even sitting still. But what this is in the senior division of it, you have corporate adult students not only mentoring the other age groups, but they compete against each other as well. And no matter what the age group, you're actually, at the end of this competition, racing on a real road course that's called Goodwood Circuit, a pretty famous road course, in the south part of England. So, shifting gears to another project now, EcoCar 2 is another green project, and it's a great example of an industry-focused university partnership program. So the EcoCar 2 program, called Plugging into the Future, is a program that's sponsored by the Department of Energy as part of the Advanced Vehicle Technology Competitions that's focused on introducing students to energy-efficient technologies so that we can help reduce our nation's dependency on foreign oil. It's a multi-year competition where the students in the first year design alternative powertrains for a car. In the second year, they have to make it work in that platform. And in the third year, they tweak it and compete again. And so Siemens is proud to be a sponsor of this, along with General Motors and the Department of Energy. So as part of that sponsorship, we provided over $476 million of in-kind software grants of NX and Team Center to the 15 universities that are involved in the competition. GM provides a 2013 Chevy Malibu to each of the schools. But the really neat part about this is that the schools actually got the NX CAD models a year before the Malibu was even released. So you had students, engineering students, people interested in manufacturing, working with the car before GM had even brought it to the market. What a neat way to get students interested in STEM. And this picture is just from a couple weeks ago at the end of the year two competition. It was held at the GM Yuma Proving Grounds where everybody had to do their first on-road dynamic tests. Now, again, taking a look at some of the teams. This is a picture of the Mississippi State team who were the winners of the year one design phase. So not only did the students have to design the alternative powertrain that they're going to build out and compete in year two with, they're judged on business skills. So they had to create a business plan. They had to recruit additional sponsors. They even had to create presentations in their own trade show booth, which they were judged on in terms of presenting and presence. And again, look at the mix of students here. Look at the young men and young women. Now, it's pretty interesting because these competitions get pretty intense. In fact, during the year two competition, some of the students who were involved in the 2 weeks of testing and competition actually had to skip their graduations to be at the EcoCar event, and they did that. And so some of these students spend literally hundreds of hours on top of their classes in the garages working on this, but it's not all work. Every once in a while, you can see that they cut loose and have a little bit of fun. So this is the winner of the year two competition, Penn State University. So their ethanol E85 electric vehicle hybrid actually was the first car to pass the safety and technical evaluations, pass the road course evaluations, and compete in all the dynamic events. And I actually got to drive this car at the business phase of the judging in San Diego, and I have to tell you, it was a great experience. The other thing about EcoCar is it's a great example of a STEM program in the U.S. that's helping to lead towards that manufacturing renaissance, so it gets a lot of attention, and you never know who's going to stop by the garage. As you can see, this picture of President Obama earlier this year at the Ohio State team with a visit. But no matter who's hanging around your garage, the key thing to me, or the most important thing, is outreach. So not only are these students judged on engineering and manufacturing and business, they actually have to do outreach into the schools as well. So they have complete social media programs, PR programs, and they go out, most importantly, and meet face-to-face with the next generation. So think about that. These students in the college and university level are our next generation of workforce, and they're being role models for the next generation behind them. And if you look at the demographics of this audience, they're doing a great job at reaching out to the students that we need to feed that STEM pipeline down the road. You can see that kids love this. They start at an early age. As we know in STEM, if you're not hitting them at the elementary school and the middle school level, you're probably going to have little interest in the high school level of actually moving into STEM careers. So if you look at the enthusiasm on these kids, on these kids' faces, and look at those arms shooting up into the air, do you think these students are more likely to be interested in their science classes and their math classes after the EcoCar students have visited them? I think they are. Okay, so now we'll talk about the PACE program and some examples of sustainable projects and green projects there. You probably heard us talk about PACE before. It's an acronym for the Partners for the Advancement of Collaborative Engineering Education. And it's partnership between GM and Siemens and other companies that is focused at working with strategically selected universities around the world. And there's 62 of them right now. And the neat thing about the PACE program is that we work together with the other sponsors. These schools come together and they share curriculum and they share knowledge and they collaborate and they compete in big teams. And we're really proud that the PACE program just won the 2013 Engineering Excellence Award by the American Society of Engineering Educators. So we're going to talk about a couple PACE programs here that are based around sustainability awareness. The most recent project that just completed was called the Sustainable Urban Transport Project. And it was a two-year project with global teams that's focused on reinventing the automobile. So not only did they have to come up with concepts to deal with that pollution and congestion in those crowded cities, they had to come up with plans of how it would be manufactured, how the energy systems needed to support that mobility would be implemented in the city, including energy storage and distribution. So six teams from those 28 universities collaborated on this project and took part in the judging. The judging was done in Shanghai, China. We have an annual global forum every year, and this last one was in Shanghai with 240 students from around the world, and industry and faculty members traveled to China for 2 weeks of training and competition. So 42 institutions actually made the trip, 12 countries represented. So I have to ask yourself, would you want to hire students that are not only have their nose in the book or they're working in the garage, but also have this global experience of working in these multi-organization, multi-cultural, multi-time zone collaboration. So students got to experience this firsthand and meet, sometimes for the first time, the other students from the six or seven universities they were teamed with around the world. So they collaborated virtually using NX and Team Center and other tools, and then got together in person for the actual contest. What was pretty neat about this is it's fun to see these students get to expand their worldview a little bit. And some of them had to expand their worldview quite a bit or go hungry while they're in China. And I have to tell you, while this may not be what they're used to eating in their school cafeterias, this was delicious. So I love this picture too. This picture, you can see in the background, the poster sections of the sustainable urban transport vehicles. And in the foreground, musicians playing instruments that were thousands of years old. So again, you know, you just can't really put a metric on what these students gain by working in these global environments, stretching their worldview, getting exposed to what it's like to truly work in today's global collaborative environments across countries. And if you take a look at some of the designs they came up with, I mean, they're just visually amazing. And of course, the winning team, which was made up from students from six universities, is, you know, winning is a pretty universal feeling. So there's nothing tops it of coming together and actually delivering that product that you needed to do and be rewarded for it. PACE has another project that started now that's in its first year, and it's called the Personal Assisted Mobility Device. And we'll be able to talk to you more about this one over the next couple years. But the idea with the Personal Assisted Mobility Device is you have a small device that you can used to get to and from mass transportation, takes you to work, you take the device, you come back, and it gets you home at night. So again, another solution to those congestion problems. So now, the last Green Wheels project that we're going to talk about is a pretty fun one, and it's here for this kind of big, beautiful solar car that's behind me on the stage. Principia College is a small liberal arts school of about 500 students. They don't even have an engineering program, but yet they compete with the biggest schools and actually came in third in the latest race, which was the American Solar Car Challenge, which went 8 days, eight states across the country. And it's a neat story. They've got a PBS documentary that was done about them in the World Solar Car Race and the last one with Australia. And we're going to have a conversation with them today. So please join me in welcoming Professor John Brewer and a couple of his students to the stage. Oh, yeah, I better get in front. We're kind of tight here today. Okay, so Professor John Brewer, would you like to introduce the students you have here with you today?
Yeah, certainly. This is Garrett Fielding. He's a chemistry major. Both of them will be seniors. So Garrett Fielding, chemistry major, and Kenneth Stack, who's a physics major.
Cool. So, John, let's start out with a couple questions for you. So, what the heck? A liberal arts school in the middle of Illinois, 500 students, no engineering program. How'd you get started in the solar car challenges?
Well, everybody likes to build stuff. It was actually a project that was approached to one of our physics faculty members. in the early 90s. And with just this idea of bringing a group of students together and working on a project, working with your hands, and, you know, attempting to do something that, you know, it's hands-on experience. You know, we're really excited about, you know, putting the students in real-life situations and, you know, going out and accomplishing it. So a small group of students, three students at the time, got together and, you know, started with the first electric vehicle on our campus, and that grew into solar cars, and 8 cars later, you have RA 7S, which is up on stage, and we're doing very well with it.
Now, I understand that you were a product of that program as well. Is that right?
I was. I attended Principia College for my undergraduate and worked on the car all 4 years, and got to experience many different experiences as well as going abroad. I went to China. I was in Shanghai and with a solar car, and eventually to Australia.
So let's ask the students a couple questions, and you guys can decide that it's a toss-up of who answers each of these. But, you know, you, I understand, don't even learn NX in a class, so you have to learn about it on your own. How do you do that? He grabs a mic. I like that.
Yeah.
I want that one.
So this last semester, I've been spending a few hours at a time in the morning working with CAS tutorials. And also just playing with NX on my own. I've gotten a little bit of help from John, and we work together as students to learn what we can.
At one point, there was a small solar car class where we learned the basics of NX, but other than that, most of it has been self-taught with the CAS tutorials, which have been immensely helpful. But most of it is just playing around and trying to figure out what works, what doesn't work. A lot of command finder use.
That's great.
It's kind of a running joke. Every time a student says, I want to learn NX, the first thing I do is I sit them down in front of a computer, and I have a little Coke can cozy, and I say, here, model this. This is pretty simple. So every time a new student sits down and the other students see what they're modeling first, you know, for their first project, everybody just kind of laughs.
So, John, hang on to that for a second. So I have a question for you. So, you know, you guys have a very hands-on approach to this. You know, what do you think is the secret to competing in these bigger schools? I mean, you guys have beat schools that are 50 times your size in these competitions. What do you attribute it to?
Well, Principia College is a faith-based school. It's a Christian Science school. And in the early 2000s, actually the year 2000, when I was on the team, we got together and really decided what did we want to be as a team. And we came up with 2 goals that we've been running with ever since then. Our first goal is to glorify God. And so everything we do, you know, we know where that comes from. And then our second goal is to always do our best. And that's, you know, not only us doing our best, but you know, when we're in competitions, making sure that our competitors are doing their best. And that idea really kind of sits with the students because they're always looking for opportunities, not only to improve our car, but how can they give to, you know, things that they've learned to other students. And that's really kind of opened up the competition and made it just this really friendly environment where teams are willing to help out. And, you know, our students just, you know, part of it is because they're not learning it in a classroom. They're having to, you know, put their feet to the coals, so to speak. They're really, you know, that desire really comes out. And I think, you know, that says a lot about our achievements.
So it's great to have the big guy on your side, but I hope technology helps a little bit in that. Do you think worked with NX, right?
Yeah, it was actually that same time that we started using Unigraphics at the time, and prior to that, when I was first on the team, the way we used to design the car was we would take little strips of foam board, we'd cut it into little strips, and we'd tape the little strips of foam board together in order to kind of visualize what the frame would look like, and then we'd say, oh yeah, the driver fits in here, and you know, we moved from that. We had some clay models that we'd, you know, designed the car in a little clay model. We used AutoCAD, you know, at one point, and in about 2000, when we got Unigraphics, that's really where the team took a turn, because we were able to design those components, do the FEA analysis and everything, and really see the car come together before we started building. And this car is actually probably one of the first cars that's the closest to our actual design because of some of the ways we constructed the materials.
Great. So back to you guys. What's the biggest lesson you learned on this in terms of maybe time management? Because I imagine you spend a lot of time on this outside of class.
Yeah, we end up spending, during the school year, it's difficult to find time between classes and solar car and extracurricular activities and sleep. I'll spend anywhere from 10 hours a week on the car during heavy terms where we're preparing for a race. I'll spend 15, 20 hours a week on the car. So there's a lot of variety, but that's a good point, is managing our time. Sometimes other things fall by the wayside that maybe shouldn't with the solar car, classes being one of those. but it's a good project to get your, it's fun. It's one of those projects that you actually want to be involved in, because you can see the product of your labor come to life in front of you, and you can watch it be built from the ground up, and you can see these models that you're designing in NX and say, well, that's cool, here's a nice digital product. But then to see it 3D printed or used in the car, or then taken to a manufacturer and made out of steel, aluminum, whatever you're having it made out of, is really neat to actually be able to see that happen, and you take a great sense of pride in your work.
So you guys use 3D printing in the car. In fact, I think the steering wheel is, let's take a look at the steering wheel, for example. So I imagine 3D printing has really changed the way that you've been able to work on the projects.
So actually, several years ago, we attended the show down in Orlando. And our booth was right across from a Dimension booth where they had a 3D printer. We were like, wow, this is, we've seen them before, but, it really started to, look like something that we could utilize. And I asked them, hey, can we print out a little model of the solar car? And they did. And I worked with them over the next year or so, and eventually got one of their machines on our campus. And it allowed our students to design in NX and start to prototype things. And one of the things that we usually prototype, and I'll let Garrett hold it up, is the steering wheel. So we designed it, printed out the steering wheel, and the drivers put it in their hands, and they said, I really need to put my fingers down here, because when I'm driving, that's how I want to hold my hands. Can we make a little cutout for the fingers? Well, now I can't reach that switch, so let's move that switch over. So we were able to go through about four or five versions of the steering wheel within a matter of, 3 days. And we came up with the steering wheel. And then after we printed it off, we said, why can't we just use this in the car? So we took the steering wheel and we put all the components in it. We reinforced the back plate with carbon fiber. And we then started our, testing to make sure that we could really use it. We put it in a vise, and we just started cranking on it. And the first place it broke was in the layers down here. And that's where we actually then went back and reinforced it with carbon fiber. And then the next version didn't break. And, so this is actually the steering wheel from the car printed out on a 3D printer. We have our number one goal, which is to glorify God, written right there on the steering wheel. And that's not the only piece in our car that's printed from the printer. We have other parts that are straight from the printer. We also have parts that we just used to prototype, and then we built them out of other materials.
Cool, that's awesome. So which one of you guys is a chemistry major and which is a physics major?
Chemistry, physics.
Okay, so, you told me a great story last night about a dance major that's doing wet layups of things as well. I mean, it's a really pretty interesting team. So we'll finish with the last question for you. So how, has working on a project like this, being exposed to engineering, I mean, has that changed? What do you think is your dream job now? Has it changed kind of how you want to, what are you going to do with this knowledge you've learned after this?
I really liked working with the materials on the car, getting to experience the properties and how some things work really well for what we're doing. And so I'm interested in materials science and engineering like Garrett.
Awesome.
And also the teamwork has really shown me what it's like to work on a large project. And I'm looking forward to doing that in the future.
Great.
This is a plug. In case anybody is needing some internship, you know, some interns, I know they're both interested in internships. And also my shameless plug, you know, I'm always looking for to put more tools that our students can utilize. You know, it's one thing if you say, oh, I'm from the University of Michigan, you know, would you like to sponsor us? You know, usually people are a little bit more willing to do that, but would anybody be willing to help sponsor a small liberal arts school that competes with the big boys?
And also, while I'm up here, I should take this opportunity. If anybody's number 3097, you should come by the solar car booth, and we have a special prize for you.
That's awesome. All right, thank you. Let's give them a round of applause. Thank you, guys. Thank you very much. Thank you. You're about. That's outstanding. And, you know, those donations of equipment to things, they're always looking for great in-kind as well. So, okay, so that was another really neat story, really powerful story of people doing amazing things. And so I promised you we'd talk about red arms, green wheels, and defying gravity. So we're going to finish up with some projects that really go kind of a little further out there. And the first one we're going to talk about is a project with the Space Research Center. We're actually doing deep space missions, working with the European Space Agency and with NASA, and it's another really amazing thing to get students involved with.
The university has been involved in space research for just over 50 years, and we're now involved in missions to Mercury, Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn. We're involved in the successor to the Hubble Space Telescope with NASA and the European Space Agency.
Bringing NX and Team Centre to the Space Research Centre has allowed all our different groups to work more cohesively together. Our electronics engineers and manufacturing teams used to operate using completely separate softwares, and we found that there was clear separation between the mechanics group, the electronics group, and the manufacturing teams. By all groups now using Team Centre and NX, we're finding there's much more cohesive environment where we engage, we interact, we discuss the design issues, and we find that the iteration between getting that concept to the final product is becoming shorter. Our future plans are to grow our use of NX and Team Centre. We will plan to get more involved with students to ensure that they get the best out of this technology. We also want to see Team Centre and NX being used not just within the engineering environments, but also used in project management and become more of an intrinsic part of how this group operates.
Maybe deep space is a little too far out there for you, but here's an example of another project. This one is deep space as well, but it's going to come a little bit closer to home, and hopefully not too close and going to miss us. But there's an asteroid called Bennu, which, by the way, was named in a contest by a 9-year-old, a contest that NASA had. It's going to be coming back and making a close approach to Earth in a few years. And there's actually a project called OSIRIS-REx that's a NASA mission that's going to actually go out, survey, land on that asteroid, and return samples to Earth. And a neat thing about this is that they have students actually building and working on the experiments that are doing it. There are four engineering students from Arizona State University that's another great users of our technology that are working on a device called OTES, or the OSIRIS-REx Thermal Emission Spectrometer. And what it is, and three of those are undergraduates, and what that is it's a device that's going to help them decide where to land on the asteroid and to return the samples from. So OSIRIS-REx will launch around 2016. It'll go to the asteroid over the course of about a year or so. They'll survey it for a couple years, and in 2023, the samples will be returned to Earth. So how cool would it be as a student to work on a project now and down the road in 2023 to be able to see the results of it being returned to Earth and know that you had a part in that. But maybe even that's a little too far out there for you. So maybe the rocks you want to work with are a little bit closer to home.
Thank you.
love this video. This was done by students at Johannes Kepler University in Linz, Austria. And you can see again how 3D printing and polymer product engineering are really helping them to bring their concepts from design to reality very quickly. And, you know, and test them in the real world. And this was a YouTube video that the students did themselves and told us that they did it, and I wanted to share it with you here today. So it's just fantastic the way hands-on activities are changing the way that we learn and do STEM education. And you can imagine the students are doing this at the college and university level, how impactful that can be at the K through 12 level as well. So as we wrap up here, I want to talk about how you can get involved and how we get involved. So, you know, GoPLM is the way we get involved at Siemens PLM Software. It's Global Opportunities in Product Lifecycle Management. It's a global program. We provide in-kind software grants to over 11,400 schools around the world. We have these great industry-focused partnerships that you've seen examples of here today, but we need more of them in other industries. And we know that STEM education, beginning at the K through 12 level, is so important. A couple of other pieces of news. Just last week, we announced that we're making our entire library of Learning Advantage commercial training on our tools, over 1,000 courses available at special academic pricing as well. And I think this is probably the most commercial training that's ever been offered to schools and universities. It's 24/7 online access, self-paced, same training that our commercial customers get. Because I hear all the time that professors don't have time to teach the tools in depth in their classes. They just have time to teach concepts. So to be able to take that learning to the next level and either do projects or have students be able to learn outside of classroom, as you heard from the Principia people, is a very powerful tool for us. We also just recently announced our veterans training initiatives. And so that's a really exciting program for us that we're helping U.S. military veterans that have a background in engineering and manufacturing make the transition back into the civilian workforce. Siemens is committed up to $17,000 of value of our in-kind training, offering courses in NX and Team Center to be able to help them get back into the workforce, build up their resumes, and contribute to the workforce shortage that we're all facing. So that program is administered for us by still serving veterans, but we provide the training. And so if you're here on Thursday, we actually are going to have a group of 20 to 25 unemployed veterans that are coming in to take some of these training classes. They'll be out in the work areas as well during the breaks and the lunchtime. So it'd be really great for you to get to meet some of these people and to help understand how, you know, our industry and how NX and Team Center and our other products can help them to find new careers. So, we've talked about a lot of things today. We saw some really neat examples of student innovation. We've heard some amazing stories about some amazing people, and we need more of those stories, and we need you to help us to create those stories. So, I want you to partner with us on these industry-focused academic programs so that we can have things beyond electronics and engineering. We can get into other industries. Wouldn't you like to be able to do some of these projects in your industries like we've seen today? You can partner with us to work with a local community college. We think they fill a key gap in the training for doing things for design technologists and skilled manufacturing professionals, and we have best in practice programs that we can work with you on that to partner with the school. If nothing else, go get involved in your K through 12 school. Use your company's interest in STEM to help get some more students in the pipeline. Hire a veteran. They're all things that you can do. We can help you get those started, but we can do more together if we work on this. So, at the beginning of the presentation, I said by the end that you'd be able to answer the question, what has red arms, green wheels, and defies gravity? And I think probably by now you can guess. It's tomorrow's workforce. So thank you very much.